share with you what I've learned because I made the worst negotiation decision of my life in 1981, which led me on a path of understanding negotiations better and trust. In fact, in the 80s, when I had this bad negotiation, I developed such an interest in trust, and I had a 2-day training program on trust. So I'm going to talk tonight to you about negotiation, but not in a way that you normally are used to hearing about negotiation. Not about tactics and strategies, but what really happens on a human level. Because we negotiate in court appeals, we negotiate with grants, we negotiate agreements, we share information. And to do that, to negotiate, if you're asking for something from someone, you must first learn the expressor mode. You first must learn how to send your message, which means asking for what you want. Understanding that even when the sign says non-negotiable, things are always negotiable because someone makes a rule or a policy somewhere. I know this. I know this from legal background. Things are negotiable. The greatest strength you have in negotiations is confidence, and the greatest weakness is lack of confidence. If you've prepared for a confrontation, for a conflict resolution session, to be effective, you've learned how to express what you want and how to ask for what you want from the others. You speak simply, clearly, and this is very important. You make it easy for the other party to say yes. You make it easy for the other. If you're in fundraising, which I am, you make it easy for others to give. If you're in a legal battle, you make it easy for the judge to visualize, chronicle, case study facts. You make it easy. Now, this make it easy mantra comes from my own coach, Iola, make it easy in the way you express. Now, when you listen to the other party, you're now in what's called the empathic mode. You're listening, and you're listening clearly, aware of, as those of you who are trained in judges, in judging, you know to acknowledge your bias and quiet it, to put it aside, to be a blank sheet of paper, to listen, as if it's the first time, to listen with respect. Even if there have been emotions involved, anger, frustration, feelings of vengeance, these are normal emotional reactions when we're injured by others. Remember, don't let your emotional self talk. Let your rational self talk. Put aside, suspend those emotions and reason. Give, even if the other person's hostile to you, give them reasons not to be hostile. This can be a really hard battle for those of us with strong egos to give and take like that. But once again, as I mentioned in the earlier segment at the educational moment, it's a bit of a stretch to say, what if? What if? What is my attitude? Is my motivation justice? Is it mercy? Or is it vengeance? The answer to a successful negotiation comes from not only asking for what you want and being clear about that, but giving up the attitude of win-lose or lose-win in negotiation. It doesn't have to be that way. The best negotiations are through synergy. Not only asking for what you want, but giving in return benefit to the others. And the secret to that is being willing to give first and to give in excess of what you receive. Those of you who've read my testimonials, you know I make a little promise when I go into a project, and then I geisha them to death with extras. So I know that the negotiation continues long past an agreement. The tip I want to give you is beware of your rational self versus your emotional self. Conflict often is involved in emotions, and we don't like discomfort. None of us do. None of us, most of us, who likes conflict here? No. All of us are averse to conflict. Yet, the skill is in learning to be uncomfortable with conflict for short periods of time. Or you attempt to use reason. That's what law is about, legis, balance. What would a reasonable person do? To your enemy, you want to have an attitude and a voice of let me reason with you. And you want to give reasons that are easy for the other person to agree with in principle, not necessarily to support your individual case. Another good tip when you're in the expressor mode, when you're expressing yourself, is have ownership of your point of view. particularly if it's a very hostile, conflicted relationship, segue with, from my point of view, as I see it, my interpretation is, from my experience, have ownership of your point of view rather than saying, Al, what you did in modifying my intro was bad. I can instead say, I would appreciate it if you had read it directly. I'm not doing any spiritual work at Solar Comforter Church. And life is like a chess game, and so is negotiation. What? How many of you play chess here? How many of you are very good? As you know, in chess, it's a visual field of play. There are two armies running at each other. And every time your opponent makes a move, even if you have a strategy for your end goal, that one little change changes everything, right? Go slowly. Don't overthink. Chess players are sometimes trained to think two or three moves ahead, but that's just a prophecy. When the opponent makes a move, everything else changes. Relax. When you're negotiating, you're expressing yourself, you're asking for something, you'll get feedback. It may be positive, it may be for more information, it may be confusion. Welcome any feedback and answer it directly. And when you're in that empathic mode, remember once again, consciously switch. Be aware of your self-talk and the noise you make. Shut off the anger, frustration, resistance, and purely listen. Listen for the other person who will give you cues. Those of you in sales know this. You'll receive cues in the objections here in sales that actually tell you what they want in order to make agreement with you. Is any of this making sense, class?
Yes.
Okay. So a conflict can be, a negotiation can be win-lose, win-win, or lose-win. And oftentimes we face injustice. I had to counsel, I got the opportunity to counsel injustice today. A mother, single mother friend of mine called and said that her son, who's a good kid, he's 18, is facing injustice with his school. He's a student leader. He is the president of his Future Business Leaders of America club. He doesn't do drugs and alcohol in rebellion against his father's model. He's a good kid. And yet, the school decided that he may not graduate in a few months because he did his homework from his bed while he was sick. And he scored more absentee days from school than any other kid. Yet, in addition to being a B-plus student, he did his homework while he was sick, from bed, and even had paper homework couriered to the school. So I don't know how many of you guys react the way I did, but is this justice? How does academic achievement track with absenteeism? This seems like an injustice to me. How many of you think this is an injustice? Read your hand. Okay. However, the truth is, there is a policy that's being enforced by an employee in the school system, and I had to tell the mother who was venting on her emotional side of speaking, I had to ask her when she said, those people, I said, remember, there's no one in the system that hates you. There's an employee who must do their job and enforce a stupid policy, just like other stupid policies we've seen lately. And I said, if you really want to affect change, you must make that personal connection. If you're in sales, fundraising, business negotiation, negotiating peace in your family. It's very important to have empathy for the other person and to realize you don't need to know everything in order to resolve the negotiation right now. Don't put that pressure on yourself. No matter how complex the relationship is, we get so caught up with goals, we think goals are only about achievement. I know many of you are beyond that. You know that goals can be personal change, objectives, not tangible things and materialism. So I encourage you not to obsess when you're in negotiation and worry about every little tactic, but focus on the connection with the person. Feelings count, as in anything. As in anything. Once again, sales, grant writing, negotiating interpersonal conflicts, business negotiations, feelings count. Focus on the connection with the person first. To illustrate, I'll share a brief story that's made by Anonymous D. Dominicus. This is called Try Softer. A young boy traveled across Japan to the school of a famous martial artist. When he arrived at the dojo, he was given an audience with the sensei. "What do you wish for me?" the master asked. "I wish to be your student and become the finest karateka, karate student, in the land." "How long must I study?" said the boy. 10 years at least," said the sensei. 10 years is a long time," said the boy. "What if I study twice as hard as all your other students?" 20 years," said the sensei. 20 years? What if I practice day and night with all my mind and effort and spirit?" 30 years," was the master's reply. And the student asked, "How is it that each time you say that when I work harder, you tell me it's going to take longer?" And the answer is clear. When one eye is fixed only on your destination, there's only one eye left in which to find the way.